Hello friends, welcome to the third episode of Health Vibes, our Facebook live chat show by Manipal Hospitals. Health Vibes is an initiative by Manipal Hospital. It's a one such kind of initiative by Manipal Hospital because you can directly ask questions to your doctors. Any questions related to health can be asked in this forum directly to the leading doctors of Manipal Hospitals. So today's topic is A to Z of heart. And the Facebook live is from 3 to 4 p.m. And in this slot, you can ask any questions related to heart. And to solve and answer to your queries related to heart, we have one of our experienced cardiologists, Dr. Ranjan Shetty. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Ranjan Shetty to this show. Hello, doctor.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. So as you know, today's topic is A to Z of heart. So we all know that heart is a vital organ in our body since it pumps blood to all the parts of our body. But we also know that heart is something is a popular organ when you compare it to other organs in our body, because maybe every film you see, any language, any film, any songs, maybe Dil Toh Pagal Hai. I never understood till now how come Dil Toh Pagal Hai, because it's related something to brain. Okay, jokes apart, we have many questions lined up today. We have already 46 questions lined up, so without wasting time, I would like to take some questions. But before that, to all the viewers who are watching on Facebook Health Vibes, I just want to tell that this show is from 3 to 4 p.m. and we are here to take all the questions related to heart. So you can send us questions, as much questions till 4 p.m. and doctor will try to answer all these questions. So with this, I would like to ask the first question, that is, the question is from Neetu. What are the major types of heart diseases?
You know, heart is a very complex organ. So since it is very complex, there are lots of disease which is possible, which includes disease of heart, the covering of the heart, which is called pericardium, the muscle of the heart, which is called myocardium. You can also have problem with the valve of the heart. But mostly when people talk about heart disease, it's almost always about what we call as coronary artery disease. As you are aware, although heart is a very complex organ, although it is filled with blood, it cannot take the blood which is there in its chamber. So it requires its own blood supply, and this blood supply is called coronary artery. There are three such arteries which come from the major artery known as aorta, and it supplies our heart. And whenever there is a problem in these arteries, it's called coronary artery disease, or in other common words, the so-called heart attack. So when people generally talk about heart disease, it's almost always about this, although there are a lot more, you know, to become a cardiologist, a person reads for 11 and a half years. So it's not just for one disease, it's for many more diseases.
Okay. And here we have next question from Anisha. What are the major symptoms for heart diseases?
Yes. See, if you see, the symptom varies according to what disease we are talking about. So let's talk about heart attack, which is more common. You know, heart attack occurs when there is a complete occlusion of the blood flow to that particular area, that whatever three arteries I described, if there's a complete block, that's where the heart attack occurs. When that occurs, generally, person gets a pain, which could be central or towards left, it could be to both. The pain is more heaviness rather than, you know, burning or pricking, it is more heaviness, it's more deeper. The person also might experience a radiation to the left arm or shoulder. It usually you don't get it beyond neck or beyond your umbilicus, but anywhere else the pain can occur. One very important thing which people should note is that, you know, there could be sweating. Sweating is very important symptom. So if anybody has chest pain with sweating, please don't neglect that. Because when you are dealing with heart disease, time is of essence. You need to treat within particular time. So don't neglect the chest pain with sweating. But if you have a pain which is like this, you know, pointing or pricking, it's very unlikely to be heart disease. But if it is much deeper, you know, you don't know where it is, you know, your heaviness is something like this, that is very likely to be because of the heart disease or heart attack.
Doctor, pain somewhere near the left hand?
Yes, left hand again is very important, but then localized, you know, just one pinpoint that area, that is very unlikely to be a heart disease. But it is vague, it is somewhere there, but you are not able to tell exactly where it is. That is very, very likely to be a heart disease, heart disease.
Okay. So we have a next question from Vinayak. Is high blood pressure related to all the heart diseases?
Yeah. This is a very interesting question. If you see that hypertension or high BP, what people call, it's an important risk factor for heart disease, but not all the heart disease, but so-called heart attack, it's the important risk factor. But it's also important risk for a disease called stroke, where, you know, people get paralysis. It is important risk for you know, the kidney failure. It's important for, the occlusion in the leg vessels producing amputation. So it's a very important risk factor. See, something to add on with the blood pressure. See, blood pressure is a disease of age. Some people would get it in younger age. Some people would get it in little older age. If somebody has a hypertension or blood pressure, don't worry about it. It's more important to actually, you know, treat it, get it treated, and then we can you know, that is the most important aspect.
So we have two questions from Pratik Gupta.
Yes.
The first question what Pratik has asked is, what are the chances of suffering a heart attack after the bypass surgery? And the second question is heart disease hereditary?
Yeah, that's a very important question again. See, bypass or angioplasty is not end of the treatment for heart disease. You know, whenever you do stenting or bypass, that particular area is treated. So there is definitely chance of having heart attack or heart disease. Again, it's possible. But although the chance is not very high, it is low, but it is possible. It also depends on how well the person has controlled his risk factor. For example, if a smoker continues to smoke, he will almost surely have a repeat event. If a blood pressure is not very well controlled, if sugar is not very well controlled, then you would definitely have a recurrence. If you are careful about your risk factors, which most people are, then the chance of having a repeat event is much, much lesser. But it is still possible. Coming to the question of hereditary, most diseases are hereditary. That's what we should realize. That means genes have some way to play in most disease. It's sometimes very difficult to, you know, pinpoint that this is a particular gene which produces this heart disease. It is very difficult. But then yes, it is hereditary. Especially if, you know, parents have a heart attack less than, say, 50, 55 years of the age, chance of child having the heart disease at that age becomes very, very high. And you see sometimes all the brothers or all brothers and sisters having heart disease, requiring to undergo stenting or bypass. So there is a significant genetic component. There is also environmental component. So it's a combination of a genetic and environmental disease. Yeah.
So the percentage of getting a heart attack or heart failure in hereditary is
higher. Yeah. If there is a parent or a, you know, sibling or a parent with heart disease, the other person, the chance is definitely higher than normal population, but it's not 100%, it's higher. Even cholesterol, if you see, predominantly the cholesterol problems are so closely related to heart disease, they are also actually genetic. So since they are also genetic, it is, you know, it's likely that it follows.
Okay. So we have two more questions from Suvideep Chandra. What are the risk factors for coronary artery diseases? And what recommendations, safety precautions would you give to a person who has already witnessed 3 heart attacks? This looks particular serious case.
Yes,
3
serious
heart attacks.
Case, yes. Yeah. Yeah. See, the risk factors for heart disease, one, we classify them as so-called modifiable and non-modifiable risk factors. So non-modifiable are something which you can't change. They are always there. One of the non-modifiable is males. Males have higher risk than women, so you can't change it. One more very important non-modifiable is age. As people age, there is more chance of heart disease. Then the third one is genetic. If there is a family history which we already discussed, the chance would be higher. But it's very important for us to concentrate on modifiable. So that's what you can control. The modifiable include diabetes. If you can control diabetes, if you can prevent it, then yes, chance of heart disease would be less. Hypertension, which is one more thing, we already discussed about that. Dyslipidemia or cholesterol, which is the change in cholesterol, that is extremely important, and you know, we need to control that. Also, you know, regular exercise helps to reduce heart disease. Diet, not too much, but diet rich in vegetable and fruits also try to reduce. If you can avoid stress, yes, that can also help. Most important, I think, which we need to highlight is cessation of smoking. Smoking is something which has a direct relation with heart disease, and as much as possible, it should be completely stopped. That is very important risk factor.
It's a very bad news for all the chain smokers.
Yes.
Okay. So next question is from Prachi. What dietary changes can I make to reduce my heart disease risk?
Okay. See, in diet, you know, for long we used to tell don't eat cholesterol, don't eat oil. This was a general recommendation which we also used to give until last year. But then last year the guidelines, lipid guidelines have changed. That means we are not too much worried about the lipid diet. That means fat in your diet or cholesterol in your diet does not matter. Blood cholesterol matters, but cholesterol in diet does not matter. So that's a good news for many people.
It's
but
good news for me.
Yeah. What matters is actually the sugar. So food rich in simple sugar, like glucose or fructose or simple sugar, these things, if they are used, then you know, there is lots of that is considered a major risk factor. So nowadays we have moved from diet to exercise, so that, you know, diet is no longer the key factor for heart disease.
The next question is from Shreyans. What type of exercises are safe for heart patients? Can they do heavy weight lifting exercises in the gym?
Okay. So it depends on what we are discussing. If the person is already, I can take it in two different ways. One, what are the exercises needed to reduce heart disease, and how should a person who has already had a heart disease or had a heart attack, how should that person, live? So that's the way probably it is better to take. Exercise is very important to reduce heart disease, because we have already described that this was one of the modifiable risk factors. So what do we mean by exercise? Should we run to gym and start exercise? Are we talking about that kind of exercise or regular physical activity? What are we trying to tell? So it is about regular physical activity. The most important exercise which we advise is walking. You know, if a person walks around 30 to 40 minutes a day for 4 to 5 days a week, it is more than enough. You know, as we know, we classify exercise into strenuous and average exercise. So average exercise is one where you can, you know, talk to your friend and keep doing exercise, like, you know, walking or maybe, you know, slow cycling, walking, or even some jogging can be done. So such exercise we recommend 30 to 40 minutes a day for 4 to 5 days a week. And strenuous exercise is where you're sweating it out and you're not able to talk, you know, playing some vigorous sports or really running fast. Such exercise, even 20 to 30 minutes, 4 days a week is enough. So this is some kind of exercise which everybody can do. We are not talking about going to gym here. Some exercise, if you want to do more, it's always good. But this is what we recommend. Now, coming back to the question proper, where we asked whether what should a person with a heart attack do. So what's very important is there is some rest which is needed initially, whether it's after bypass surgery or after heart attack. You know, there is a wound and you want it to heal. So that's what we are talking about here. You want to heal that wound. So generally what we recommend is first 2 to 3 weeks that they should be in rest. Doesn't mean bed rest. They could be walking around. After that, every week we advise that they increase their effort exercise by 1 kilometer. That means by 2 to 3 months, they would be doing something like 4 to 5 kilometers. Then cardio exercises are better. If you want to do weight training and go to gym, you can do it, but you need to start slow and go up slowly. The trick is to do it slow. See, the person with heart attack or heart disease can do everything, but there is a time. They have to do it slowly, they have to do it with time, and later, as the time progresses, they can definitely do everything. Yes.
Okay, doctor, how about doing yoga exercises?
Yes.
Surya Namaskar.
Yes. What I would say is yoga is good, if you should be doing it, but don't do it as a substitute for your exercise. What we recommend to our patient, all of them, is do all your exercise, 30 minutes to 40 minutes, also do yoga. Because yoga, again, is not controlled. You know, people can be just shaking their hand and calling it yoga, which may not be enough exercise what we recommend. So do your walking and also do yoga. So it's like, don't take it as a, you know, alternative to each other. Do both.
So we have next question from Prachi.
Yes.
Do I have to stop exercising after my bypass? I guess Dr. Ranjan Shetty has already answered this question.
Yes.
And next question is, would you recommend jogging as morning exercise to a heart patient?
Yes, that's very important. As I repeatedly, I keep telling, you need to start slow and slowly increase. Now, you can do it in the morning or you can do it in the evening. That is up to you and whatever time you have. The cardiac benefit of morning and evening is almost same. But just for people who have hypertension or high BP, which we already discussed, a morning exercise is considered better, because in which case the whole day BP would actually be lower. So morning, evening is up to you, but some exercise is what we recommend.
Doctor, I had a question, if you see majority of the cases of heart failures,
yes,
most of the patient, they go through this heart failure only during mornings. Like maybe around 5 o'clock, heart attacks.
Yes, yes.
It's early morning it happens.
Yes.
And I just want to know, why is it so?
Yes, there are multiple reasons. This is a very important question, because you know, the timing of heart attack itself. The heart attack can occur any time, but you know, they have some predilection to early morning. There is a reason for that, you know, going by your, if you see your hemodynamics or your the endocrine factors or so-called hormone factors, by morning the body is making you get, you know, it's get making you ready to get up and do all the activities. So some hormones, you know, get activated way before, something like 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, they're getting you ready for 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock. So they would get activated, and the blood, if you have to put it in very simple word, I can tell you that blood is thickest in the morning, and mm-hmm. heart attack is something like a clot. So in simple terms, mm-hmm. that is what happens.
Mm-hmm.
So there is a diurnal variation. The key point here is what we should probably emphasize is not wait till morning. If you have a problem in the night, better visit in night, because in heart disease or heart attack, there is a concept of golden hour. Golden hour is nothing but the first hour. The maximum death occurs in first hour. The greatest benefit, if you do a procedure which is angioplasty or stent or stenting or giving some, you know, the fibrinolytic or some blood thinner medicine, the best benefit occurs if you do it in 1 hour. What we see in our practice most of the time, that people, you know, sleep over it, because they think they have to wake up one more person, and it is, you know, difficult. It is not so. If you have a problem, you need to visit fast, because the benefit will be maximum.
Mm-hmm.
Any person who can take a ECG can diagnose a heart attack or heart disease. So it's very important they get it. And in cities like Bangalore, traveling at night is much easier. So we strongly recommend, if there is a symptom, you should reach the hospital. So.
So to all the viewers, I just want to say, like, in case if you get any kind of heart pain in your chest or pain in your left hand, just don't ignore it. Just move to your nearby hospitals and just get it checked. I guess ECG would...
ECG is done, you know, I mean, not that ECG doesn't miss heart attack, it does miss, but the chance, that's a small percentage. But
okay.
it would still pick something like 90 to 95% of the heart attack.
Okay. So moving towards the next question from Arvind Angadi. Can heart patient walk in steps? What is the medicine you prescribe to increase the LVF, sir?
Yeah. So heart patient, by meaning people with heart attack, can definitely walk in steps, but slowly, that's what we recommend. So they should probably be starting taking one flight maybe after 2 weeks, unless it is absolutely necessary. If your house is in second floor and you have undergone angioplasty, you have no choice. In which better to, you know, take breaks in between. The for heart failure is a different disease. That's what we should understand. When we talk about heart failure, your heart muscle is weak. So there are many reasons for that. One important reason, or 70% of the reason, is actually heart attack. You know, you have a blockage, and that's why the muscle is weak. So that's one disease which needs to be taken. But there are other reasons also where the heart becomes weak. So the other could be, you know, intrinsic problem of the muscle. Could be the valve leakage which is producing it. If I have to tell, it's like an end result of many, many, many diseases, including some infection, some inflammation, hypertension, the BP itself, diabetes itself. All this can produce a weaker heart. To improve it, first, you know, we have to identify why there is weak heart. If it is, you know, because of the block, you treat the block. If it is because of BP, you control BP. If it is because of, you know, blood sugar, you know, try to control it. So you need to manage most of them. Once you have managed all these, it's better if we add some medicines like beta blockers and ACE inhibitors and aldosterone. There are some drugs which can help. There are also devices which can help, which are like pacemakers, and it can be put. So these are the things which can definitely help these people.
Okay. So there is a next question from Dayanand. And this is one such interesting question, I guess you might get to hear from any kind of forum wherever you go. The question is, can a heart patient drink alcohol? Is it true that a glass of red wine daily is good for heart?
Very controversial question in a social media. You have to, you know, be very, I should say there should be a warning that this is only for a select subject. What we should realize is, what we advise is limit alcohol. So the amount of alcohol which is, say, allowed for a heart disease patient or any other patient is 60 ml of hard liquor or 100 ml of wine. Now this is a very small amount and non-addictive dose. Not most people cannot stop at this. So this dose, whatever we are recommending, is shown to have some benefit. But any excess is shown to have harm. So what we say is, don't start drinking alcohol to protect anything. It's probably definitely not worth it. But if you are already drinking, limit it to 60 ml. That is just, you know, one large peg or two small peg. Something which most people are definitely not happy about, but that's what you should do to protect yourself.
So it's 60 ml in a day.
60 ml in a day, and very important thing is, you can't drink 240 at end of a week or Saturday. It's not, you can't add it up. It's just 60 ml a day. If you're drinking only on Saturday, again, it's just 60 ml a day. Yeah.
So we were just 60 ml a day. Yeah. You can't add up, and yeah. Weekends, no. You can't drink 240 ml.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. No mathematics.
Make it clear. Yeah, no mathematics. Yeah. Yes. So the next question is, he has asked two questions. It's from Karan Kundani. Can we prevent heart disorder? How can we stay protected from heart disorder?
Yes, there are many ways. The prevention, as all of us know, is always better, and it definitely has a value. The prevention depends on the disease which we have. As I told in the beginning, there is non-modifiable and modifiable. So prevention aims at modifiable risk factors. Now, what are the modifiable ones? Hypertension, diabetes, lack of, you know, stop smoking, limit your alcohol, start your exercise, be careful on your diet, see that you don't put on weight. So this is how you limit. So by doing this, you might be either preventing it or at least postponing your heart disease, and that's worth it. That's what we are talking about when we talk about prevention. Whether complete stoppage is possible, I'm not very sure. But if you can postpone it by a decade or two, it is definitely worth it.
What should we do if the symptoms for heart disorder comes very fast?
Yeah, heart attack is like an earthquake, so it's definitely fast. There are two types of heart disease when you talk about coronary artery disease. One is heart attack, second is a stable disease or stable blockage. So in stable blockage, I already described about three coronary arteries. So in stable blockage, the block starts developing, and that person gets chest pain while walking, when he exerts. When he goes to climb stairs, he gets chest pain radiating to arm or neck. And when that person takes rest, it subsides. This is a stable heart disease. This is the minor of the two problem. It is okay, it's not okay, but you can get a treadmill test and get angiogram and, you know, find out what it is and get treated. The other one, the most important one, is a heart attack. We already described the symptom of heart attack. It's sudden, it occurs on chest or, you know, radiating, it occurs at rest, it continues for more than 5 to 10 minutes, there is associated sweating. When this occurs, time is of essence. That's what, this is a repetition, we have been already talking about this. Golden hour concepts hold true. If you have to anyway go to doctor, do it then. And if it's night, do it night, any time. Get a ECG done, consult a medical professional. It can make lot of difference. Because as I said, majority of the problem, you know, people who survive are anyway going to survive. The people who will succumb will be the ones who will succumb very early in this disease. So they should get the medical help as soon as possible.
Really very unpredictable heart.
Yes.
Disorder.
Yeah. Yeah. Even like in the previous day of the heart attack, the person can be normal. Even if you do angio, it could actually be normal. There is no need to have block on the previous day. But at the time of heart attack, there will be a block. Now, what happens there? It's good if you can understand this. See, we already discussed about coronary arteries which supply the heart. The arteries have little cholesterol deposits. What we know, what we describe as plaques, which are small deposits which are there. During this period, the plaques break. There is a break in plaque which we call as plaque rupture. It ruptures. And then, you know, body anywhere, if you have a cut, its first response is to clot. So the blood starts getting clotted. So artery which was 10%, 20% or 70% blocked, now suddenly because of blood clot becomes 100% blocked. That's heart attack. So now the heart is actually crying for blood. The pain, what you are seeing, is a cry of the heart. So you can't neglect it. as soon as possible we need to open it and, you know, make the channel there, and it can be done today, you know, with advanced therapy all this can be done, but your response, your benefit is time sensitive, so time is of essence here.
Okay, so next question is from Surendra, and he is having a very big question. It goes like, I am a cardiology patient, and at times I face situations where I can't breathe properly, and major shivering happens. This English is kind of weird, so I'm making grammar correctly and I'm saying okay. And major shivering happens that time. Can you suggest what could be the reason? He means to say that he shivers. He's a cardiology patient, and
yes,
he shivers. In some instances. And also, I am a big fan of having good physique, but I can't work out because I am not supposed to work out since I am a cardiology patient.
Yes.
And he wants to know what kind of food he can eat if he wants to go to gym.
Yes. The gym is, the concept of gym is good here. So what we should do is, the first of all, we should realize what problem he has, because it's varied. You know, it's very difficult to tell exactly what problem he's having. He's definitely a person who's had a heart attack. And I feel from the explanation that heart could be weak. That is a possibility here. If your heart is weak, if you're not, you're getting symptomatic at rest, you're not able to do anything, then you need to take some medicines and stabilize it. And after that, after stabilizing yourself, start with, you know, minimal activity, walking and, you know, minimal or just, you know, low intensity cardio. Once we know that you are able to do it and you are better with that, that is the time you switch to some gym and muscle, but should not try too much strenuous activity, especially if your heart is weak, should not try too much strenuous activity, yes. But gradually you can do. And diet-wise, as I told earlier, we are not very strict about diet, we just advise to avoid sugar and simple sugars and this. Fat can be taken, protein can be taken, eggs can be taken. So, you know, diet is not a major issue even when you are doing this.
So the next question is from Amisha. How important is diabetes as a risk factor for heart disease?
Yes, the diabetes is an extremely important risk factor. There is no doubt. People believe that diabetic, you know, if you have diabetes, it is as good or as bad as having a heart attack. It's considered that bad earlier. Nowadays it's considered not that bad, but it's still a very important risk factor. So diabetics tend to get heart attack much earlier, their heart is much weaker, they tend to have much more block. It's very difficult to treat them by angioplasty, most of them require bypass surgery. So it's a very bad risk factor. But luckily, if you control it well, the things can be better. Things can be better. It's not about being diabetic, the control also does matter. So early on, if you pick up and if you control, you can actually do better.
So the next question is from Sheen. What she is saying is, I have my cholesterol level under control through medicines, and now in recent report, my blood sugar HbA1c is 7. What can you advise me on diet, exercise and glucophage?
Yeah. I think this person is probably diabetic and also has a cholesterol problem. So it's very important. 7 is not a bad GlyHb, it's reasonably okay, but it's good to get it down maybe to 6, 6.5 if possible. And then, you know, any exercise is better. The thing about exercise is, first step is to do exercise. If you start doing exercise, that's much better than not doing at all. So my advice to most people is just start doing exercise. That will be the maximum benefit. And when you do, if you can do it for 30 to 40 minutes, it's very good. Now, the glycophage is a drug which is used for sugar control, and it's one of the, metformin is a drug, and it's one of the very good drugs, and you know, it should be, if it is prescribed to you, you should take it and control your blood sugar. And also diabetic diet is nothing but a healthy diet. It's not the diet which only diabetics should have. I think if the whole world has diabetic diet, it's better. Now, it's simply telling that, you know, eat what you can digest, don't eat too much, space it out, see that you don't put on weight, decrease your sugar intake. That's all the diabetic diet says. So you just have to follow these diet advices.
The next question is from Geet. How common is heart disease among women? Also, can children get heart disease?
Yes, yeah, the women do get heart disease, there is no doubt about that. But there is a difference, that's probably what we are trying to see. Generally, women are considered protective during their reproductive age group. So, but they do get, but they get 1 decade later. Like if men get at say 50, the women get it at 60. That's what happens. But if there are risk factors in a woman, like if they become hypertensive, diabetics, or if they smoke, so if any such risk factor is present, all the benefit of being a woman actually goes. There is no benefit then. They behave worse than men. So one other way is in women, the symptoms are very, very atypical. They have, you know, little different. It's whatever we describe that classical symptom may not be present. Sometimes because of this, the presentation will be delayed. So women should not neglect if they have a symptom. And it's important for women also. It's the number one killer even in women. That's what we should realize in Western world, and it's catching up in India. Now, children having heart disease is a different story altogether. When we talk about children having a heart disease, we do not describe, it's not the same heart disease what we are talking. It's not coronary artery blockage or coronary artery disease. When they have heart disease, it is more to do with something called a hole in the heart, which will be which is a communication between a left side and right side. As you are aware, heart has a left-sided chambers and right-sided chamber, and they don't mix with each other. They're separate. You can take it as two hearts which are put together. So left, right doesn't mix. So if there is a hole, sometimes the blood from left comes to right, and in which case they have hole, and then they have breathing difficulties, they have repeated pneumonia, and they don't gain weight, and they are very sick children, infants as well as neonates, very sick ones, and they need some therapy. The holes can be closed by surgery or percutaneously, the way we do angiogram, the holes can be closed. The other kind of heart disease which children have is the mixing of impure and pure blood, you know. The right-sided blood now goes to left. Such babies are called blue babies. So the children appear blue. That's again one more disease. If there is a blue baby, it needs to be treated early. That should not be neglected at all. The holes also needs to be treated, but you get some time to treat them.
Okay. So they actually go blue?
Yeah, the blue babies actually grow blue. Okay. I mean, that's because of the mixing. You look at their lips, they will be blue, and their hand will be blue. The mother can, it's not blue only when the child cries, it's blue all the time. So, you know, some kids become, you know, they hold their breath and become blue. That's called breath holding spell, you know, some which during their tantrum, they just hold their breath, but that's okay. That's not a serious disease. But the child who is tired all the time, which is blue in the face and blue in the arm, their fingers are generally swollen, that's called the blue.
That's the symptom,
and that needs to be treated.
So the next question is from Avinash. How is cholesterol linked to heart? Is red meat bad for your cholesterol?
Yes, again a good question. Cholesterol is definitely linked to heart, but to specify, it is blood cholesterol which is linked to heart. That means anybody who is above 21 should get their cholesterol checked, and if it is high, you need to be treated. 90% of the blood cholesterol is actually genetic. It's not from what you eat, but it is what you are made of. It's genetic. Hence, it's very important for you to, you know, if there is something, you need to, you know, get it treated. And just diet may not work. So, since diet is not important, the red meat does not matter now. So, people, if they want to consume, they can. Egg white was anyway considered good. Egg yellow is also okay, because whatever extra cholesterol you take, your body can digest it. If you are not eating cholesterol, body can as well produce cholesterol. So dietary cholesterol does not matter. Blood cholesterol does matter.
So doctor, I had a question. I wanted to know what exactly is bad cholesterol and what is
the good
cholesterol.
Yeah, if you see lipid profile, if you get a lipid profile, then it gives multiple, you know, multiple reports, and some of them give it in red, and people get scared looking at the red. It's difficult to interpret.
Red circle.
Red circle and red, but not all red are bad and not all blue are okay. So there's some, you know, science into it. But then generally your LDL cholesterol or low dense cholesterol is considered a bad cholesterol. So higher value of this is definitely bad. So anything about 190 is definitely bad, and anything less than 100 is good. That's where we go with LDL, low density. The other cholesterol which we talk is called HDL, or high dense lipoprotein, HDL cholesterol. This HDL cholesterol is considered good. That means higher the value, it is better. So that's where we are. The one more cholesterol which is very common in Indians and which you get is called triglyceride. So if you are triglyceride is high, then it is intermediate cholesterol. You know, it's not bad, not good, but definitely not good, but it's not that bad. That's how we can put that triglyceride. It's related to what you take. You know, HDL and LDL cannot be modified with that. Triglyceride can be. Diabetics will have higher value. If you eat lot of sweets, lots of fat, your value will be higher. That is where triglyceride is. Triglyceride above 500 produces pancreatitis, hence it is bad. The lower value you need to correlate with other reports and you know treat it. So it's not just a knee-jerk reaction, not looking at a value and treating. It's more about treating the whole patient rather than just the value.
Okay. So next question is from Rajat. What cholesterol level is recommended for a heart attack patient?
Yes, that's very important. See, again, as we discussed, there are multiple types of cholesterol. See, LDL less than 70 is very good for a heart attack patient. Mm-hmm. If the patient has a heart attack or a bypass surgery or is undergone angioplasty stenting, then it's preferable to have LDL less than 70. But less than 100 is also okay. More than 100 is not acceptable. So that's what you do. And to do this, it's not possible with diet, as we repeatedly discussed. It's important we do it with drugs. So most of the time, people with heart attack or heart disease will be on lifelong medicine for a cholesterol lowering, which is good for them. They should take it.
Okay. The next question is from Mudit. Does smoking can cause heart disease? Can the heart rebuild its strength after quitting smoking? How long before it gets back to normal?
Yes. It's a very serious question. Yes. Smoking is definitely associated with heart disease. It's at the cost of reputation we are just telling it. You know, person who is perfectly normal, one cigarette can produce heart attack. And you know, you have done the angio, it's normal. Because it is one of the important risk factors for plaque rupture. So stopping it definitely helps. So the benefit starts immediately, but some harm might be left. You know, it's like a scar. So scars heal, but you know, they leave some marks, so something remains. But definitely as the time passes from the event, like 5 years quit smoking, 10 years quit smoking is definitely better than not. So whoever is thinking of quitting should quit it now.
So for the viewers, quit smoking. Smoking is injurious to health.
Yes.
Just keep this in mind and stop smoking.
Yes.
So next question is from Valsala. Are birth control pills a contributor to heart disease?
A very important, interesting question. Yes, there is, the earlier they were considered extremely safe. They're not that safe. They can increase heart disease or heart attack, which is there. They also increase the thrombus formation. There is, but not in everybody. It is in little susceptible. HRT, on the other way, which is called hormone replacement therapy, which is given in older individuals after their menopause to prevent symptoms. There are hormones which are known as HRT. They are also quite harmful. More than, you know, oral contraceptives, HRTs are much more harmful because you give it to an older subject and it's taken for a much longer time. They are more harmful. So you need to discuss with your doctor before you start. Yes, that's a very good question.
So the next question is from Avinash. Do most overweight people develop heart disease?
There is this is a interesting question. Yes, overweight people do get more heart disease compared to, you know, the lesser weight people. That is true. But one good part is that they do better than the thinner people. When they get heart attack or heart disease, the obese people who are overweight do better than their counterpart. That is, it's called obesity paradox. Although they get more disease, when the disease actually comes, they do better. And it's true for many diseases, not just heart disease. It's true for, you know, the infection. It's true for the sepsis, infection, some kidney disease. Most diseases is actually true.
But how is it better actually?
No, this is just a study data which shows that they cope up with the illness better. That is what. But then obesity is not just, or being fat is not just one thing. In medically, we classify obesity into just obese and metabolically obese. Now, these metabolically obese are one who have so-called insulin resistance. They have higher insulin level, but they need not be fat. See, these metabolically obese do worse than real obese. There are some people who are obese, but they don't have diabetes, they don't have BP, they don't do that bad. But there are some thin people with diabetic and BP, and they may be actually metabolically obese. As we put it, that's bad. So it's a little complex when you talk about obesity, but losing weight helps. That is sure.
Okay. So next question is from Anish. He has two questions. First one is, can stress cause heart disease? Second one is vitamin E good for heart?
Stress does produce heart disease. It's very difficult to quantify how exactly it does it, but it does produce heart disease. So it's believed that when you have acute stress, you tend to get acute heart disease like heart attack. When you have chronic stress, you get more like blocks, like a chronic disease. Then that's what happens when you have acute and chronic heart stress. Now, coming to vitamin E, it's never been totally proved that it's very beneficial. So if it's given to you for some reason, you can take it, but don't take it just to prevent heart disease.
Okay. So the next question is from Deepali. This is kind of, are diet pills bad for heart? I'm not sure what diet pills is.
Yes.
Are diet pills bad for heart?
Yeah, there are lots of diet pills which are available. Some of them are caffeine antagonists, some of them
it
are...
It helps in reducing weight?
Yeah, that's what they mean by diet pill. There are injections which are available. Some of them are bad, you know, they you don't know what is there in that. That is the first thing. Some of them are not very safe. Yeah. So if somebody takes it, they should take it for a short time rather than a long time and try other ways.
So, diet pill, is it something like supplement what we take, protein shakes or something?
No, I don't think so. I think it's more like instead of diet you take a pill. That's how it looks like from the question.
Okay.
It's probably trying to, you know, pill to reduce weight, and you see lots of them in internet anyway.
How about taking supplements?
Supplements
like you skip your breakfast and have some bar which contains all the nutrition.
I think it's not very useful. Because see, what we realize is when you take something, there's a lot more than what you know. You can't take glucose. You can't take protein just like that. These fibers do have their role. So you need to take natural things than supplements.
Okay.
Maybe we can leave the supplement to astronauts who need to take it. Others should probably take natural.
Okay, so the next question is from Anisha. Are cardiac scans a good way of detecting heart disease? What exactly is a cardiac scan?
So there are lots of cardiac scan. I think the person is probably referring to echocardiogram. Now echocardiogram is a test which is just like ultrasound of the heart. Just like you do ultrasound anywhere, you do ultrasound of the heart. When you do that, you get lots of information, which includes the pumping, whether the heart is pumping well, whether the heart valve has a problem, whether the heart is thick because of this one, or whether the person has had a previous heart attack. So you get all this good information. But then blockage cannot be picked by that. See, that's what people are interested in, whether I have a heart block. The echo is not a good test for that, because resting, when you are resting, you are fine, and you take a echo, it's a resting echo. Not very good. To pick up blockage, you need tests like TMT or a treadmill test which pick up. There are also other heart scans like talliums and stress talliums and such tests which are available. They are also useful in getting some, you know, picking up heart blockage. So there are lots of tests available. Each of them have their advantage and their limitation. So probably they should be done when your doctor, you know, advises you rather than, you know, you opting for it without consultation. It's better if somebody sees it.
So the next question is from Vaibhav Sharma. How to spot a mini or harmless heart attack? And
yes,
he has asked one more question, that is, does heart disorder has any specific prone age?
Yes. And I think there's one more question which I can see, that whether aspirin should be taken every day. It must be from the same person. So I think we can answer all of them, all of Vaibhav's questions. So what is the first question?
So the first question is, how to spot a mini or
mini heart attack. This is something which people talk about, a heart attack as a major heart attack and minor heart attack. See, what we mean by major heart attack is, you know, where there is a complete block, with the one which I explained at that time, where the treatment has to be done immediately. That is major heart attack. Minor heart attack is where you have, or mini heart attack is where you have a small blockage, you know, small changes, and then you know sometime it is closing, sometime it is not closing. So we tend to describe this as a minor heart attack. But there is nothing minor about a minor heart attack. All the minor heart attacks tells us is that, you know, we don't have to do angiogram that night. We might do it next day morning. It gives us some time, you know. If it is a major heart attack, if it is night, we have to do it in the night. There is no choice. I can't say, you know, I'll do it tomorrow. That's not possible for a major. But minor, we know that with medicine you can stabilize and you can do. What's very important is untreated minor heart attack is worse than a major heart attack or as bad as major. So don't take a heart attack as minor or major. You need to treat it well. That is very important. The about aspirin question which Vaibhav has asked again. See, everybody need not take aspirin. Take it only if it's recommended. No drug is absolutely safe. There are issues with each of the drugs. So if it's, you know, the aspirin also produces the gastric bleed, sometimes it produces brain bleed, so the benefit is not high. But there are some groups where we give aspirin, but everybody need not take it.
Okay. I guess Vaibhav Sharma has got answers for all three questions.
Yes, one more. I think we have got diet pill, which we have already answered.
We have already answered. Yes, yeah. I guess Vaibhav has lots of questions regarding heart. When it comes to heart, everyone is concerned. I don't know why is it. When it comes to heart, everyone is concerned. Next question is from Gul Hassan. Is it true that higher the age, higher is the risk of heart disease?
Yes, yes, it's definitely true. Age, have the important risk for heart disease is age. It's definitely true. But just to share with you the sad state of our country, that younger also get heart disease. If you see in Western world, they get heart attack in 50, 55. Or maybe even 60, 70, that's what they get in Western world. But in India, we have been having heart attack 2 decades earlier. That means 30, 35 and 40 people have heart attack. Although older get it, but our country, the younger get it. This produces a tremendous economic burden on our growing economy. Because now there is a younger person who is a breadwinner, who has a heart disease. And you know, some of them change their profession, change their thing. They have to, you know, their lifestyle changes. It's very sad. But then most people do have some risk factors, smoking being the most important one in younger individual. So it's very important that, you know, people control it. So we have seen people having heart attack even at the age of 20 and 21. So age is an important risk factor. Doesn't mean younger are protected. They are not protected, but older tend to get more. That's where it is.
Next question is from Ayushi. Should one eat different foods if he has heart disorder?
The food, I think we have discussed, it's about more about limiting your sugar, not really about your fat and oil. See, one question which we tend to get all the time is what oil to take, whether coconut oil is okay, whether, you know, that support olive oil and all that. Now we can tell you it doesn't matter. Whatever oil you take, it doesn't matter. Don't take too much. See that you don't gain weight every decade. Just limit it. That's what we should. Egg, yellow is okay, that's one more common thing which is that the whole egg can be taken if you want to take it.
Any amount of egg?
Any amount of egg is okay. Again, I think the most important thing is, you know, maintaining a balance. Just because something is okay doesn't mean we need to take it too much, or something is bad, we don't have to stop it. The balance is the key thing, you know, it has to be balanced.
Okay. So there is the next question from, she has three questions from Jyoti Joy. Should I start any exercise to make my heart stronger? I guess you have answered this question already.
Yes.
How often do I need to visit doctor?
What can I do
to feel less stress during heart problem?
Okay. So I'm sure you don't have a heart problem, so there's no this one. So what's important is the visit to doctor is, it's little controversial, it can vary. If there is, see, one, it's very important after age of 21, it's better to get one cholesterol done. After 40, better to get your sugar done. So this is something you must get done. So during this time, you can actually have your health checkup, what you are doing. Otherwise, if you're not very symptomatic, you don't have to visit your doctor. Do visit if you have symptoms. If you're perfectly fine, you may not visit your doctor. And stress, as you rightly pointed out, stress has a role, but stress is endogenous. That means it comes from within. It's not the outside people who make us stress, it is we ourselves. So there is, you have to control it yourself. We have realized sports and yoga and relaxation exercises do help in stress. People should opt for it if they are stressed.
So the next question is from Vibin Kumar. Is heart disorder can be cancer if we don't take precautions of. What he means to say is, will heart disorder turn into cancer?
No, that's a good part probably. That heart disease do not turn into cancer, but they're as bad as cancer. If you see in today's era, some cancers people do survive more than 5 years, maybe 60%, 70% survival is seen. There are people who get cured of cancer. So it is, I'm not here to talk about cancer, but then heart disease could be equally bad. Like heart failure, some of them don't live up to 5 years. Heart attack, sometimes it is very, very difficult. So it is, these are two bad diseases to manage, but they can be, they have their own way, but they don't lead to one another. Otherwise, sometimes seen, you know, people with cancer have heart attack, which is also seen, and they need, sometimes they need therapy if it is advanced, sometimes just a medical therapy is given.
There's one interesting question from Vinay Kirtania. I was expecting this question actually. I wanted to ask you this question, but Vinay has asked this already. If anyone gets a heart attack, what should we do at first to save them?
Get to hospital. The key would be to go to hospital. Otherwise, you know, if you are sure it is heart disease, then aspirin in this juncture helps. Some people have, you know, if they already have a disease, they will have a tablet called, you know, nitrate or sorbitrate, which is there in their pocket, which can be put. But whatever said and done, the importance of early revascularization, the artery which is blocked 100%, is not going to get open, you know, just by sitting. So it's very important for people to seek medical help, get an ECG, get an echo, you know, ECG especially, and get it treated. So that's what we need to do if there is a heart attack. Medical, get medical help, don't neglect it. See, what we see, as you rightly pointed out, people are sometimes cardioneurotic, they are really worried about heart disease. But when it really happens, they don't come.
They neglect it.
They think it's not, it's gastric on that particular day. But when it's atypical, when it's not, they do come and get lots of tests done. So it's very important to, you know, have a balance. Do that, but do this also. And it's not a, it's okay to come and get your ECG and know that it is gastric and not a heart disease and go back. That's okay. It's not the wrong thing to do. You don't have to worry. Nobody is going to laugh at you because you have come in night for your chest pain. We all understand it's a serious symptom and we respect that. So you can visit a doctor in night and get it treated.
So this is a question from Pratik Gupta. Is there any avoidance of food to be done to avoid heart disease? I guess the doctor has already answered this question. Then it's from Vaibhav Sharma again. What do if symptoms are really coming quickly in heart disorder?
I think this was asked.
Okay.
No, you need to reach the hospital.
Huh.
Yes.
What precautions shall I take to not give stress on heart? What she means to say is, what should she do to maintain stress or avoid stress?
No, I think that was specific stress on heart. The sense, how do I not stress my heart?
She meant, what precautions shall I take to not to give stress
on
heart?
Heart, yeah. You know, people believe that some particular things produce stress on heart.
Okay.
But you know, when your heart is normal, more you stress it is better. More you exercise, more you stress it, you know, stress the heart. It's actually better for heart. So there should be less stress to your mind and more to heart. That means you do more exercise, but don't take tension. That's better for heart and mind both.
Doctor, what heartbeat is good actually? To be
the
a very
rate
good person.
Yeah. See, heart rate.
Usually athletes, you see very less.
Heart rate is very variable. The normal heart rate varies from 60 to 100.
Mm.
So anybody can have it. Lower heart rate need not be bad. It, you know, especially lots of athletes, if they are very strenuously exercising, heartbeat actually comes down to something like 50. There are people with 30 and 35 also. It's considered a sign of, you know, good. The best heart rate is between 50 and 60. The maximum survival, if you see, is between 50 and 60. But then it's just one predictor, so don't go by that, because now you get lots of gadgets to see your heart rate. So I think you should not panic just by your heart rate. Change in heart rate is sign of life, so there is nothing. You know, heart rate will change if you are living, so you have to accept it.
Okay. And the question from Subhadeep Chandra: how do the symptoms of heart attack differ between men and women? I guess.
Yes, it is a very interesting question. As just to, you know, read this one. Yes, women have little atypical symptom. Their symptoms are not very specific. They should not neglect it. Just because their chance is less in particular age group does not mean they won't get it. They will get it. And I mean, they can get it and they can prevent it or protect themselves, so they should not neglect. There's lots of atypicality. The tests which we do are also not very sensitive. You know, TMT which we do in men, it is very reliable. In women, it's not that reliable. So women also has to be more careful. Yeah.
We have some more questions we have got live.
Yes.
It's from Nikita. My aunt, what she wants to say is, my aunt experiences severe chest pain every time she climbs the stair. Can it be serious symptom of heart disease? What do you suggest?
I think it is, Nikita. So what you are dealing with this here is not a heart attack but a stable heart disease, in which case probably there is block in her coronary arteries, the arteries which supply, and when she is walking she is getting pain, and when she is resting she is okay. So this is what we know as a stable heart disease. Such a person should see their doctor, get an echo done to rule out any heart attack, maybe get a treadmill done or directly go for angio, because this is a textbook description of a heart, you know, a block in the coronary artery. So maybe they should get an angio done and, you know, fix the block. But again, since she is a female, it's not necessary there are blocks. Sometimes there are no blocks, but that's your lucky day. But with this symptom, you should take it very seriously and get it treated.
So the next question is from Edison. I have been experiencing random left chest pain for the past 2 months. I also noticed my resting heart went up from 54 to 77. Should I be concerned?
This Edison may not be a heart disease, but there's no way to be sure. If it just random comes for 2 minutes, 3 minutes and it's just pricking or burning, it may not be. But then it's very important that you get yourself evaluated, which might include an ECG and a treadmill test. A treadmill test will be very important when you have symptoms like this. And if a treadmill is normal, I don't think so, you have to worry. So you see, the first person symptom was so classical, the second is not very classical. So heart disease symptoms keep varying. It's not about just any chest pain. When it's classical, we do know from history itself. Yeah.
So next question is from Rohan. What he wants to say is, I am 23 years old. My father expired because of a heart attack. I am not an alcoholic or a smoker, but I have lived a stressful life in the last 5 years. I want to do a heart checkup. Which test should I do?
Yes, I think Rohan, what is important is you have a risk factor, but it's not a must that it gets transferred. One important thing to get it done is your lipid profile. You need to get your lipid profile and look at your LDL cholesterol, because you know one way it passes genetically is lipid test itself. If lipid test is abnormal, you need to treat it. It's also worthwhile for you to get one echo and treadmill just to be sure that there is nothing much. And stress, as we keep discussing, is very endogenous, so you need to, you know, find out a way that, you know, stress you off for a stress-free life.
The next question is from Shreya. Does depression increase the risk of cardiovascular disease?
I think so. Yes, it does, because depression itself is a very stressful condition, and we already discussed the stress as a direct relation with the heart disease. So it's very important that people, all these diseases needs to be treated. They need to be taken seriously and they need to be treated. If there is a depression, treat it. If there is anxiety, get it treated. So because then, you know, they all get added up and it all, you know, affects your heart as you know, even common words, you know, common language also, they think it's a heartbroken and heartbreak and all that. But some of them do affect heart really. Yeah.
So coming towards the end of this episode, we have the last and final question. That's from Nasreen. Is pacemaker really helpful in heart failure cases?
Yes, this is an interesting question. It's not really called a pacemaker, but the therapy is almost the same. If the ejection fraction is less than 35%, if you are pumping normally 60, but less than 35, and you have certain features in ECG, then a pacemaker-like device called a CRT, cardiac resynchronization device, helps them. The way to put it is just put like pacemaker. Normal pacemakers have 2 leads, but this has 3 lead. It has 3 leads. So you just put that, and it does help in a select group of patients. So there is a role for these devices. These are called device therapy, and there is a role for this. There is also a role for medicines, as we discussed.
Yeah. So doctor, we have come to the end of the show, and the questions are done. So I would really like to thank you on behalf of all the viewers, because you have given your valuable time to us and enlightened us with your knowledge and given us some vital facts about heart disorders and heart problems.
Yes.
So I'd like to really thank you once again for coming and being the part of the show Health Vibes and making it a successful one. And also I want to thank all the viewers.
Yes.
Who have been the part of this Health Vibes Facebook live chat. And I would like to tell you one more thing, that we'll be coming up with the next episode of Health Vibes very soon. And meanwhile, please like this video and share this post on your Facebook. And also like our page Manipal Hospitals on Facebook. So with this, I would like to tell thank you. Stay fit, stay healthy, stay happy. Signing off, it's Nishant. Thank you.
Thank you.